trying to do an interview here, right, with me.
I can see by the look in your eye you want to get a bigger piece of the pie.
Welcome back to Disney Marvels for a week of August 2nd, 2020. This is episode 95. Disney Marvels, the show about Disney, Marvel, Lucasfilm, Muppets, Pixar, Fox, the parks, and much, much more. If it has to do with Disney, it's fair game. I'm your host, Matthew Graykin. Hey, we'll be right back after these messages and words from our friends and sponsors.
Hey Matthew, Jim Hill here. I do the Marvelous Disney podcast with Aaron Adams over at the Jim Hill Media Podcast Network. I know, very humble sounding name. Anyway, I really enjoy what you've been doing over on the Disney Marvels podcast, but as you probably already noticed, the Marvel Us Disney and the Disney Marvels podcast names are very, very similar, which is why I imagine I keep getting mail for you. That's actually why I'm calling today. I wanted to know what you'd like me to do with all of these Yankee Candle catalogs, please get back to me. Keep up the great work with the Disney Marvels podcast.
Thank you for those kind words, Jim. And make sure to check out Jim Hill on the Marvel Us Disney podcast with Aaron Adams to find out all sorts of wonderful things about Disney, well, Marvel, particularly what's going on with them. And Jim, those catalogs, I'll make sure to give you the forwarding address. And unless if you want to order something, go right ahead. And once again, make sure to check out Marvel Us Disney with Jim Hill and Aaron Adams, wherever you find or listen to your podcasts. And now, on with the show.
Why are there so many songs about rainbows? And what's on the other side?
This year, because Disney Plus made an announcement, a small announcement. Well, let's say it was a long, extensive tweeting announcement that a certain group will be coming back to Muppets or coming to Disney Plus shortly, or in this case, they already have. This is Muppets Now is the brand new Muppets series following up from the movies, the former ABC series. They now have their own streaming series, which is absolutely brilliant. And I could not think of anyone better to talk to it with than, of course, our good friend Matt Leonard. But just to make it even more enjoyable, because not one Matthew or Matt is enough, two is still not enough, I decided we needed a third Matt on the show, no other than Matt Vogel, the man who knows the Rainbow Connection like the back of his hand, and every 80s track out there in reference. Matt, thank you for coming on board. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me, guys. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you on. And Matt Leonard, how are you doing?
I'm doing quite well. Thank you for having me back. It's an honor to be here.
Oh, honor's all ours. Honor's all ours. So, as I mentioned, Matt, you just launched Muppets Now, fantastic
right.
series.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's I really enjoyed it. I was watching it with my daughter, and she was cracking up.
Oh, good. That's what we want. You know, we want you to be able to watch this with your family. So, mission accomplished.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And she's right in that perfect demographic. She's 14, so you're hitting that teenager segment, so
fantastic.
Let the ratings know that, you know, they got, you're getting good marks.
Very good. I'm gonna make a note of that right now.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know that I'm in charge of the ratings.
Oh, excellent. Ooh.
It's really hard. I don't know what I'm doing, but I'll figure it out.
See, I can only count up to five on two hands. Or in Muppet's case is, I guess, six on two hands, right? Three on each. Depends on the Muppets.
Yeah, usually four, but yeah.
So let me start it off. Let me go back to the beginning. Because I want to talk about you, because you're my guest, and your career is fantastic from where you began to where you are now. So how does a guy from Kansas break into public television and puppetry?
Well, it is a long story that involves a little boy who makes puppets when he is a kid because he's obsessed with The Muppet Show and with Sesame Street. And it moves to that kid growing up a little bit and becoming an actor, deciding he wanted to be an actor. And then further, that kid wants to be an actor, so he moves to New York. And the short version of that story is that when I was moving to New York, my then-girlfriend, now wife, Kelly, saw an ad in the backstage newspaper that said, "Do you measure up to be a Muppet?" And it was a picture of Kermit the Frog, and they were looking for somebody my height, my weight, left-handed, which I am, but I'm a right-handed puppeteer. And so I answered the ad, and from that ad, I kind of got in the door. I met John Henson, Jim's youngest son, and he brought me on to be his understudy for a real world version of a CG Coca-Cola polar bear. And that was my first gig with the Jim Henson Productions, now Jim Henson Company. And I would sub in for John when he was unavailable, and I would go to, you know, different supermarkets or different Coca-Cola events, and I would meet people in this giant Coca-Cola polar bear puppet. And that's really how I got in the door. And from there, I did some workshops with Kevin Clash and Camille Bonora and Jim Martin and some other puppeteers. And I was then asked to come in and audition for Big Bird.
Wow.
That's kind of how it happened. That's the short version.
So you and Kelly ever look back and think of the irony of that picture to what you're doing now?
Yes. it's crazy that happened all of those years ago, and that it was this picture of Kermit, and now here I am, taking care of that character.
And what an honor that must be.
It is. You know, it's humbling to play Kermit, and it's, I'm not going to lie, it is a big responsibility. But you can't really be thinking of that when you're playing the character. You just have to play the objectives of the character like any actor would do. But it is a big responsibility. So much of that character is Jim Henson. And my goal, whether it's Jim or whether it's Carol Spinney, who played Big Bird, or Jerry Nelson, who played the Count and countless other characters, and or Richard Hunt, who's another guy who's a character that I now perform. My goal is to honor that Muppet performer's original performance as best I can, while still letting that character grow and evolve and live. That's kind of my goal.
And you've done it so wonderfully too. I can tell you that for me as a Muppet fan, Jerry Nelson is one of my favorite performers within the company. And I remember being very conscientious years ago, watching a bunch of his characters and thinking, nobody's ever going to fill this guy's shoes. And you've come in and across the board, you've nailed Floyd. The new guy doing Floyd. Count is just so note perfect. I don't even think about it. And what you've done with Uncle Deadly, you ran the ball right into the end zone and done a little dance with it. You've gotten further with that character. It's the funniest. You've made Uncle Deadly the funniest character to come along in probably 20, 25 years.
Oh, that's very nice. Very kind of you.
Really, a resurgence of that character.
Yeah.
What's that? What'd you say?
It's more of a resurgence of that character, because he kind of just went away. Muppets Tonight was almost non-existent.
Yeah, I don't even remember seeing him on Muppets Tonight, but he was on The Muppet Show in a few episodes, and as the vaudeville, as the actor, as the Phantom of the Theater. But then also he would also be in some acts as kind of the villain, and I talked briefly with Jerry about Uncle Deadly. There wasn't even thought that I would be playing that character, And he mentioned John Carradine, the actor, a famous actor who just had this big, rich voice, this massive voice. And this is coming from Jerry, who had an amazing voice. His voice is just was so rich and beautiful. And I was a big fan of Jerry's work and of his voice and his vocals as well. But him to hear him talk about, you know, how he had this, he was one of his heroes was this other actor who had this amazing, rich voice was pretty cool.
Yeah, it's always interesting to hear of people that you idolize and think you do your craft so well, and then hear the people that they look up to and that they aspire to. Because there's always someone that, you know, that even like Jim Henson, there was people that he looked towards and he was aspired by. So to hear who these people are, it's always an interesting and kind of brings it down to earth.
Yeah, it really does.
That kind of connection that, wow, they, I think they're fantastic and they do their job perfectly, but they see beyond that and they think of someone else in the that same aspect. I was going to ask you, you know, taking on such iconic roles, Kermit, Big Bird, Confound Count, Sweetums, all these wonderful characters. I mean, how much of a burden is that on you from day to day at times to times?
It's not a burden, really. I mean, it's, you know,
and maybe burden is the wrong word, I think, but I'm sure. Go ahead.
I was going to say the challenge of being truthful to that character. What are the challenges of being truthful to those characters?
Thank you.
Well, you know, Kermit has been around since Kermit's been around since 1955. You know, and my Kermit growing up was Jim Henson. My Big Bird growing up was Carol Spinney. My Count was Jerry Nelson, and so on and so on. And now there's a whole generation of kids whose Count is actually me. And I realize there's a whole generation of people whose Kermit is Steve Whitmire. And I get it. And that's okay. You know, I don't hold, there's nothing I can hold against them for that. But no. It's my job to do the best that I can to do my version of Jim's version of Kermit. That was the directive. That was the direction that was told to me. I want to honor that. I want to honor that with every character that I play. And it's not a burden, or it's so much as and I'm sorry, you said it's not a burden, but what are the challenges?
Yeah.
But those are challenges is, you know, you want to meet expectations. You want somebody to see Kermit or Big Bird or the Count or whomever and go and not notice, not really notice and not go, oh, wait, that's not quite right. And it's a little bit different in puppetry, I think, because, you know, there's a whole other set of skills that are happening that doesn't have to do with the voice.
Right.
There's the manipulation. There's the acting part of it. There's the camaraderie with your fellow Muppet performers. There's just a whole host of other things that are stacked upon each other that hopefully, if they're all stacked nice and neat, you come out of it with a character that makes somebody who sees something, they go, ah, that's Kermit, or oh, that's Big Bird.
Yeah. I to put people at ease that may say otherwise, you posted a video during this wonderful lockdown of Kermit performing Rainbow Connection, very basic, in the, I don't know where you filmed it, backyard or
Kermit Swamp, as far as
Kermit
I know.
Kermit Swamps. If anyone had any sort of question, that is such a beautifully done rendition of Rainbow Connection. I just instantly fell in love with it.
Oh, thank you.
And if you were to tell me that was not Jim, I wouldn't have believed you. in all honesty, because I absolutely adored it. It was, like I said, it was beautifully simplistic.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I it really means a lot for me. My buddy Lucas Ross played the banjo for Kermit on that, and he's a great banjo player and a really great guy. And we just had this idea in doing that video. First of all, it was inspired by that. There's a Steve Martin video of Steve just out in the woods during this time. In March or something, and you can see it's like he's put his phone on a tree or something, and he just backs away from the phone and starts to play this beautiful banjo tune.
Yes.
And I thought, I really should do that with Kermit. And, you know, I went through the channels and asked if I could do it, and they said, yeah. And so I asked my friend Lucas to create a banjo track, and we did it, you know, and I'm really proud of it. I mean, you know, nowadays there's a lot of rod removal. We do a lot of rod removal mm-hmm. with our shows and with our projects. And for this, we just really wanted it to feel authentic and in the moment. And like he just did it just now and just put it up on the internet right now.
Honestly what it looked like.
So we didn't remove rods. We just left it as it was.
Yeah, no, it came out really well. And I, to be honest, I sing to my boys every night. Their lullaby is a segment of Rainbow Connection.
Ah, that's great.
Years now.
My son, that's strange because it's actually my son will actually request that. He doesn't do it often, but when he does request, it's that and then the song from Sesame Street, "Don't Want to Live on the Moon." Those are like his two lullabies. Yeah.
For 19 years, I have been singing "I Don't Want to Live on the Moon" I have 5 kids, so that's why I'm not singing it to the 19-year-old.
Yeah.
But I have been singing that song to my kids. That's the song that my wife and I sing when we're putting them to bed. Is "I Don't Want to Live on the Moon." And we've done that since the oldest was, you know, born.
Oh, that's awesome! It's
great songs. So you know you can't beat the classics.
That's true.
Such wonderful songs. I did sing that to my daughter a little bit. And I ended up going really singing to her just the "You'll Be in My Heart" from Tarzan. That's kind of the song that I felt connected me to with her, especially since she's adopted. So the whole theory behind that song and what it means, I just felt was appropriate.
Yeah.
And then my sons and I are both biologically mine. And I'm like, okay, well, that's my daughter's song. I need something else for them. And so that's why I went with Rainbow Connection, because it's such a beautiful song. It just got such wonderful lyrics to it. And,
it really is. It really, it's a great song. As I actually had somebody on, I think my Instagram, they were like, sent the masters or something. Are you ever tired of that song? And I'm like, no, I'm not.
I just can't.
I have the privilege of singing that song. It is a great song, and I love every opportunity I can get to sing it.
It's an honor. It really is an honor to be able to do that.
Yeah.
Speaking of honors and performing, so Matt, you wanted to go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go just go what you're gonna say.
I think you know where I'm going. I was going to go the Outside Lands Festival.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Were you involved in that?
I was. Yeah, absolutely. We had this special stage built for us so that you could see the at least Floyd and Janice. You could see them full body. So I don't know if you've seen pictures from it, but there. So we're all in black. We're in black hoods and black, you know, everything, black gloves and everything. So you can't really see us. You kind of can, but if it was at night, it would have been totally amazing. We got an afternoon slot, but they made it so that. So I had I was puppeteering Floyd, and I operated his, you know, the puppet, the head, and also his feet to make him walk out and stand there. And then somebody else was doing the bass. For me, but it was a blast. It was the energy from the crowd was unbelievable. It was there was so much love that was just shooting at all of us behind that. We could feel it, even though we weren't really totally seeing them because we were behind these flats. It was a great ride. I would love to do that again someday.
It was really, I saw the video, I saw it when it streamed, and it was, yeah, it was really one of the most exciting things I had ever seen. I'd seen the Muppets done in a long time, because the characters really were, actually, it wasn't the daylight, it was the smoke machine was your downfall, but until the smoke machine set in, I was sitting there going, wait, how are they doing that?
Yeah.
And to watch, you know, at one point Janice and Floyd go back to back and are kicking their legs in the air, or to watch Zoot do a saxophone solo and walk across the stage. I was just, it was amazing.
It was so much fun. It was hard.
Alive.
It was hard, but it was fun. And they had built for us these special rigs for our arms, because, you know, you got to hold your arm up, and they wanted us to kind of do back to back songs, which, you know, doing one song is like, you're done, but you got to think it's not only the puppet, but you're also carrying the puppet's instrument. And so they had built a special rig. Jane Gutnick had these rigs built that would kind of support our arm as much as you would allow it to support it. And those were lifesavers for us.
Oh, I'm sure. I saw some of the video as well. I didn't get to see it live, but that was incredible.
It really was. And I think it was kind of a testing ground, a little bit of a testing ground for the Muppets Take the Bowl.
Yeah.
I think that was kind of a little bit of that, just to see, you know, what would it be like if we brought these characters out in the real world in a live setting like this?
Oh, yeah. I wish I could have seen the O2 performance particularly.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun too. It's you know, the Hollywood, it's very similar to the Hollywood Bowl show. There's a little bit more, you know, it's tailored slightly more for the UK crowd, but overall it's a lot of it is the same shows that we did at the Bowl.
I'm somewhat of an Anglophile, so that kind of works in my favor. speaking of which, Mike Quinn says hi.
Oh, hello to Mike Quinn. I love Mike Quinn.
Yeah. We did an interview with him about a month ago, and we had a lot of fun with him. We had a lot of fun with him.
Yeah, he's a great guy, and he's been around for quite, I think he's about 126. I think that's how old he is. He's been around forever. And so he's very old. No, but he's been around since he was a kid.
Yeah, he's, I know he was telling us how he started, he bribed his way onto the sets in London. And got to know Jim, Jerry, and all them, and Richard that way, kind of being the background. They said, well, you're here anyway. Yeah. We might as well put you to work.
That's right.
Nowadays, that can't happen. But
no, the rules are a little different now. But that's pretty cool.
Speaking of videos I found on the internet, I found this little one that LL Cool J put up of his show Lip Sync Battle.
Yes.
I've never seen so much life out of it, or I have, but it's been years and decades really since I've seen so much life out of Big Bird. And particularly in what I found was more amazing than Big Bird's performance of both songs was the audience response. And they're not little kids. I'm talking like 20s and 30 something year olds going wild for Big Bird, and then Elmo popped up, and Cookie Monster, and them going completely bonkers for the characters. And here's Big Bird performing these songs. Amazing lip syncer. He's fantastic at that. And wonderful dancer. I like I said, I can't, last time I remember, you know, thinking it was amazing seeing Big Bird on roller skates, which I can't figure that one out.
I can't do it.
Or ice skating.
that seems really tough. I'm amazed by Carol that he was able to roller skate and ride a unicycle, I believe, too.
Both I have actually heard the most impressive thing, and the most impressive thing that Carol has ever done. Supposedly, Carol did an appearance where he was doing Oscar being carried by Bruno on roller skates, and he had to do like Oscar and Bruno at the same time while he's on roller skates.
I buy it. I think I have no doubt that he did it.
I can't remember that. I remember Bruno the few times on, obviously that's quite a little setup there. But yeah,
I mean, but you know that lip sync you were talking about. Yeah. You know, I had to learn the dance. I had to learn I got a video, and there I am in my hotel room in Los Angeles, running the video back and back and back, and just trying to replicate the steps of the dancers. And when and this is before I had met them, and I came in that morning, because you're there kind of the whole day, and I came in that morning to work with the dancers, and they said, "Well, do you want to try it, or do you want us to show it to you?" And I said, "I'll just try it. I'll jump in." And I did it, and they were it was just me dancing with them, with my arm up in the air without Big Bird on, and they were they all lost it at the end, because they were like, "Oh my gosh, you were so prepared." And I was like, it doesn't usually happen, but this felt like I needed to really be prepared to dance.
Yeah.
Cause that was in some intense dancing that Big Bird does. But
I was wondering, like, were you just coming out that with on the spot, you know, just getting into the music and just going crazy with it, or how rehearsed was
rehearsed.
Like you said, and to rehearse in that, cause Big Bird's an awkward position.
Yeah. Yeah, he is. And it's here's the secret of it. I'll tell you guys, I haven't really told anybody, but the secret of it, when we were shooting the song, I Got a Feeling song, we shot it in three pieces, because I said, I will never be able to make it from beginning to end. I will die. I won't be able to do it. My arm will die. So we picked two spots to stop. So we did the beginning of the song up to a certain point, and then picked it up again for the middle part and stopped, and then picked it up for the ending again. But it's all one dance that I had learned that they put together for me, which was pretty cool.
It's edited beautifully, and everyone goes along so well that you'd never know.
Yeah. Yeah. They did a great job.
And John Legend came out to see you.
Yeah. He and his wife Chrissy are friends of Sesame Street, you know, and they bring their they brought their daughter there, and she was there, Luna was there as well, and it was really, she was having a great time. It was fun. And Jason Schwartzman, who was my opponent, was just a gem. He was such a great guy. He was so game to play, and he's hilarious too. So it was so much fun playing with him.
Well, you had to know he didn't stand a chance against you. Against a 6-year-old giant yellow canary.
Yeah, answered the call, and he said, "Oh, yeah, I'll do it."
That's something else. So before I go into Muppets now, Matt, you have anything for Matt?
No, I'm good. Oh, I thought you were talking to me. Sorry.
Actually, can we double back just a little bit? Because you've taken on so many of Big Bird and so many of Jerry's characters. Could you talk a little bit about the two of them and what you were able to gain from them and glean from them?
Talk about Jerry and Carol?
Carol, yeah.
Yeah, so and Carol always treat. Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
No, and sort of just your general memories of them. Because I think they both need to be talked about.
I agree 100%. So Carol and his wife Debbie, Carol, they always treated me like I was their son, always, from the day I met him, kind of, when I met him and was introduced to him, and they said, "This is Matt Vogel," and his eyes lit up, and he was like, "Vogel, that means bird in German. This might be the job for you." And I was like, now I have to put the bird on and like do an audition for you. But he was always so, the thing that I take from Carol is in his performances, he is an actor who is always very in the moment. He's very in the moment, and his performances, his reads from take to take were different. They were fresh and alive. You know, when he was feeling good, you could feel he was feeling good. When he wasn't feeling as good, you know, in a bad mood or whatever, you could kind of feel that a little bit. Thankfully, he was usually playing Oscar on those days. but he just was very kind in how he treated me and in how he shared this character with me, because there was a lot of time when we were kind of working, you know, hand in hand with that character where I would be performing Big Bird and then he would put the voice in later. And he trusted me. He trusted me to do that. I was going to take care of that character. And, you know, and his wife, Debbie, is just a wonderful person. And I've never seen two people so much in love with each other. And they had this tenderness and kindness and sweetness and playfulness that is so rare and that is just beautiful to see. And then I'll never forget that about Carol and about Debbie. And Jerry, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Matt.
Oh, and I was going to, well, I think it's, you know, because I've met Carol a handful of times, and I think one of the things that struck me with him is that there is this kindness and this warmth that just surrounded him. And I couldn't help when I walked away, one of the first times I met him, I spent some time talking to him. And as I walked away, I couldn't help but think, you know, it takes a special type of person to play that character. There's so many ways that character could have gone wrong. He does it so right.
Yeah.
And it's almost kind of almost sort of a chicken and the egg concept. Like, does this warmth and the humanity come from doing Big Bird for so many years? Or does the warmth and humanity of Big Bird come from Carol? And I think there's a little bit of, there's a symbiotic relationship.
I think they
there.
Feed each other. Yeah. Yeah. I think they fed each other over the years for sure. Yeah.
Because I shared that with, I was talking to one of the other Sesame Puppeteers, and I shared that, and they agreed, and then went, and he's Oscar, too.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I was going to say. I was like, and then there's also the other side, which I think was also that, you know, he would bring that to the role, and then they kind of mixed. Some of Oscar became some of Carol, and some of Carol became some of Oscar.
How feng shui.
Yeah.
And Carol has also said that playing Oscar saved him years of therapy bills.
Yeah.
But I'm sorry, you were going to start talking about Jerry.
And Jerry was just, you know, he was just such a remarkable guy. He was such a great performer. I always, as you mentioned, Matthew, I always hearing his voice and seeing him do these characters, whether it was you know, New Zealand, or whether it was just a guy that came in like, you know, yeah, a football, he's playing a football, but it always just had this quintessential Jerry Nelson feel to it. I feel like the unsung heroes of the Muppets. I feel that his voices are so unique and his performances are so vibrant and bold and beautiful. And, you know, one of the things that I learned from Jerry is that he said to me, you know, Sesame Street's great, but always have something that's your own that you create. And that stuck with me, because Jerry always did. You know, there's a story about, you know, he had a place up in the Cape, and he was up there for years meeting people, knowing people, friends with people before people even, and he never mentioned Sesame Street and never mentioned that he was the Count. And they didn't know until, you know, they found out. But he was just that kind of guy that was, he had this life over here that was the Muppet life. And then he had his own life, his other life over here that was music and having fun with friends and having that thing that you can create on your own that is your own is the biggest thing that I learned from Jerry.
The music part. So is that why you have, I saw some music videos on your YouTube channel.
Yeah. Yeah. I have a band, but that's not from Jerry. I mean, that kind of was predated Jerry saying that to me, I believe. Yeah. It's just this little band. It's just not really around anymore. It's just, you know, cause we're all over the place. My buddy mm-hmm. Michael's out in LA. A couple of the guys are in New York, one, you know, one's in New Jersey. I'm where I am, you know, it's just, but it is something that every once in a while we'll get together and make something, create something.
Awesome. Awesome. I just hearing you talk about that, I remember when I was doing my due diligence and checking these things out. And those popped up. I'm like, interesting. So he does, I mean, obviously you need to have some sort of music capability to be doing these performances that you do. So why not? It just seems natural. It's like, okay, why not have a band? Why not go around performing?
Why not?
Yeah.
And we did, we performed in New York a lot. We did, you know, we would gig out. And I was the bass player as well as the singer, but I was the default bass player. I didn't know how to play the bass when they were like, you're the default bass player. I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, nobody else wants to play the bass, so you're playing the bass. And I was like, okay, I guess I'll learn how to play the bass.
So is there some irony there that you kind of didn't want to be a bass player, didn't have a bass player, and now you're Floyd?
Yeah. But Floyd's a heck of he's way cooler bass player than I ever was. That's for sure.
Is that a help to you in playing Floyd, having that ability and that skill?
Or just the experience even.
You know, I mean, I think it's helpful a little bit to have in what we do. For me, I found it helpful to have a little bit of musical experience. I played trumpet when I was, you know, in grade school all the way through high school, and I could read music because I had to learn to read music doing that in the school bands. And I played a little bit of piano. My aunt would try to teach me how to play piano, but it didn't really stick and I didn't stick with it. And so it stuck with me. And I'm glad it did, because it does come in handy. We do a heck of a lot of songs and singing and stuff like that on Sesame Street and with the Muppets, and it's come in handy.
I can imagine. I want to bring it back to the Muppets a little bit.
All right.
A couple years ago, when the Muppet movie came out, and you were involved in that, and then, by unpopular opinion, the Muppets Most Wanted, which is actually my favorite of the two, came out. How was working in that to kind of start this bringing the Muppets back?
Well, it's fun. It's fun to do a movie. It's really fun. It's hard work. But when you're working with the Muppets, it really makes it fun. And working on the first Muppet movie in 2011, you know, there were some growing pains and trying to figure out how to work things with crew and with performers. And it ended up being a really, you know, by three weeks in or 4 weeks in, we were all having a great time and doing nothing bad was happening prior to that. It just, you know, there's a little bit of
growing pains,
learning curve when you're working with the Muppets for the growing pains, learning curve when you're working with the Muppets for the first time, because you know there's a lot of things that we have that normal actors don't, like monitors, and you know we have to see what the shot is or it doesn't work. And
why is this guy lying on the floor?
Right. Yeah. Can't his head go lower? No, it's as low as my head can go. And that's as high as my arms can reach. But by the time we got to Muppets Most Wanted, I kind of felt like we kind of were in a groove. And I agree with you, Matthew, that Muppets Most Wanted, I feel like it's a funnier film. It's a funnier film for sure.
Yes.
I think that the Muppets, the first one, kind of tugs at the nostalgia a little bit more, whereas I think the second one is just a pure kind of a caper film, if you will.
Yeah.
Yeah, the first one, we're getting the band back together. The second one, we're back together. Let the chaos begin.
Yes.
And I thought in the Muppets Most Wanted, a lot of the secondary characters were used so well, just the payoffs of a lot of things. You know, like I'm trying to think, there was a thing with Bunsen and his bomb detector, which is introduced about a third of the way into the film. And it's the bomb magnet. Funny Bunsen and Beaker moment. And then to see that play out in the third act.
Yep.
It's great. Or to see, you know, they do the ladder and then you have Gonzo hooking the helicopter with his nose. That's a joke 30 years in the making. You know?
Great. And it was a blast. You
know, Bobby Benson and his baby band helping the band. This is fantastic stuff.
Yeah, you know, that was a funny bit that I just thought of this moment here when you said Bobby Benson and the babies. You know, they kind of become Ricky Gervais's henchmen, kind of this little. And when we were shooting, there's a scene Ricky won't care that I'm telling this story, but there was this scene when the camera is on Ricky and on the backs of the heads of the babies when he comes into the safe or something. And when he came through the door, all of the babies would be like, we were making little sounds, you know, Dominic, Dominic. We were just cracking him up, like continually cracking him up to the point of where he was like, guys, please don't say anything. Just pretend to say something. I'll never get through this. It's just too funny. And, you know, we had to keep quiet, and it was fun. He was such a great sport, and I loved working with him because, you know, he was a great audience for me as Constantine. And if you look at any of those press junket videos that Ricky Gervais does with Constantine, Ricky is legitimately cracking up time and time again. It was so much fun.
So let's talk about how did Constantine come to be, or how did you come to be Constantine, I guess is the better question.
Well, there was an audition, as there was for Walter in the first movie. There was an audition. And so there was an audition with James Bobin, the director. And, you know, he was already written as a Russian bad guy, world's most dangerous frog character. And I don't know if it was really thought through how stupid he was. I'd like to think that was kind of us working on it and finding that character and realizing he really is an idiot. Like that's what makes him really dangerous is that he's so dumb. Working on that with James and trying to come up with like, and I had a dialect coach help me with the accent and how much we would bend the accent to, you know, when he was trying to be his Kermit, you know, he always was being a terrible, it was never intended to be like a legitimate interpretation of Kermit. It just ended up being that, you know, he got slightly better at it as the film went on. You know, the thing is, none of the Muppets ever really realize, like, what's wrong with him? What is wrong with his voice? I think they do say some version of that, but creating the
animal catches on, I think.
Yeah, animal, of course. That makes sense. No.
Yeah.
Well, fun to put together, though. And it was great to work on the set, too, and evolve him on the set and find little moments on the set, too, with Ricky and with James.
Yeah, I like the forcible way that Constantine was saying Miss Piggy's name is like, oh, it almost had like a disgust to it. Like,
yes.
Oh, it's you.
And again, yeah. I think there's an irony.
He did not like
it. We were talking earlier, but there's an irony of you. You know, your whole career is kind of irony because your last name is Vogel and you're Big Bird. You're not a bass player, and now you're the great, in my opinion, the greatest bass player. And then you start out playing not Kermit the Frog, and that's now transitioned you into being Kermit the Frog.
Yes, I know. It's not lost on me. I am aware, and I'm just very grateful.
Yeah. You know?
Well, we're definitely grateful as well that you have now taken on these mantles, and you're doing so well with them.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Like I said, with Big Bird, you brought in such a life back to the character that, in not any fault of Carol's, because I mean, it's something nobody has figured out how to fight is you get older, and as you get older, you just can't do things like you did 5, 10, 20 years ago. And now you know you've been able to take it on, and you've brought that life back to that character. And Count, again, you just have this energy. Anytime I see your characters on screen, there is an energy to them that conveys across, that just kind of you instantly gravitate to watch that character.
Well, and thank you. You know, that really does come though from those original performers, and I throw it all to them because that's what those characters were. Those are the way that I play those characters is how I see and hear them in my head. So. And that comes from Carol and from Jerry and from Jim and from Richard.
But some credit does go to you as well.
It's very kind.
You're they're, you know, as beloved as they are, you are now the one performing them. So, if it wasn't for you to be able to convey that, you know, it would not be there. Which I guess I will use that to swing it around to the newest thing, the Muppets Now. Okay. That you know, Kermit hasn't been in it as much as you would think Kermit is. I mean, he pops up here and there. He does a little photo bombing with Walt, which I don't. There was that peculiar word. I meant to write it down and look it up to see if it was actually a word that he used to describe photo bombing.
I don't remember what it was.
But
I'm sure it is. I'm sure it's what that is. What's that?
He sort of speeds through the word photo bomber or
photobomb.
Yeah, there we go.
I think we messed with that a little bit and said photobomb. Yeah, just to try to find like what make it sound more
professional.
Professional. Yeah. Photobomb. That's right.
It's a great hobby for Kermit. He hops in a picture. He hops out.
Yeah. Who knew? Yeah, it's a fun show. We had a great time making it. We made it about a year ago. And, you know, what I've been saying is I think it addresses the question of what would the Muppets comment on in the age of streaming and reality television. So it's, you know, you get that, you have a like a cooking show, but it's seen through the lens of how Swedish Chef sees it.
Yeah.
It's twisted in some way, or that interview show, Mup Close and Personal is an interview show, but something always goes wrong. It's not going the way you're thinking.
I thought watching them, the Mup Close and Personal, the first one you guys did with RuPaul, I watched and I thought this stands right up there with the original Muppet Show. I mean, it feels exactly like Kermit interviewing Julie Andrews or Kermit interviewing Candace Bergen or something like that.
Yeah.
So well written.
Yes.
The character coming in and just creating chaos for this interview that Kermit's trying to do seriously. It's very well done.
Yeah, it is. And there's a lot of made up stuff that just kind of finds its way in there, which is what's beautiful about it, is this kind of, there's a lot of improvisation that happens. I mean, you know, to a certain extent. And I do feel like there are things in this series that harken back to the zaniness of the Muppets. Something else I said early on was like, it's not the Muppet Show. It's a Muppet Show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't want people to be thinking, oh, they're doing the Muppet Show again. You know, that would be great, but that's not what this is. This is a Muppet Show, and you're still going to get all those characters that you love, and they're going to be acting in the way that you want them to be acting, and you can watch it with your family. Yeah. And that's what this show really is, I think.
And it's hitting at a good time because it's so playful and it's good, clean fun. And
yeah,
we kind of need that right now.
Absolutely.
I think that's what the world needs. The world needs more Muppets.
When I posted that, you know, when it was officially announced that July 31st was going to be the release date, and I posted on the show's Facebook page, the responses of people were just so overly excited, and the thing got shared, seen by hundreds, thousands, whatever many people. It just people were eating it up and just could not wait. They were so happy. They were so thirsty and so ready. And I think, like I said, performances at Outside Land, the even the lip sync battle, it shows that people how much they care for these characters.
They really do. There's a lot of love for the Muppets, and you know, we're all conscious of that, and we want to do projects that are going to reflect, you know, that we're going to meet the expectations of what our audiences are expecting from us.
Yeah. And I even said to Matt when we watched the first episode, I said, this reminds me a lot of just in the style of the original Muppet Show, where you have Scooter kind of running things behind stage, and it's all these little vignettes and skits of the characters going on. Whoever thought of Miss Piggy doing a fashion vlog is brilliant.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
And Uncle Dudley being her assistant, I guess would be the best way of putting it.
Sure.
tormentor. the way that he just kind of shoves her off and just kind of
I mean they're good friends,
in her face insult her, but at this
I agree. There's a lot of great moments, and I'm really proud of that. The stuff with Eric, getting to work with Eric as Piggy and with me as Deadly is so much fun, because they are I love the combination of Piggy and Deadly, because they're both kind of full of themselves, and they both feel like they're better than whatever it is they are doing in that current moment, and yet they're stuck together.
Yeah, it's meeting the diva with another diva. It's a counter diva.
It is. Pretty it is much. Kind of a counter diva, yeah.
He can either acquiesce to her, and yes, of course, or he can meet it with an equally diva-ish. And the other thing, you've got a real tool there in that Uncle Deadly is one of the few Muppets that can actually mumble the way he's built. So for him
to... I know. It's a great tool that I've been able to really, really work to my advantage. But he is he's a great puppet.
Yeah.
I love him.
It comes across so well. And like I said, you guys just play off each other so fantastically. Yeah, Piggy asks you, what's my your best feature? Oh, I would say my beard. Oh, you meant yours. choose your words carefully. Everything.
Yeah, they're a great combo. I love, and I get to, do that with one of my best friends. So that's also fun.
They say this show is unscripted. How unscripted, if I may ask, how unscripted is the show?
So let me give an example of like the Mup Close and Personal episode. I think we had some questions. And so I would try to ask those questions. And then I think we probably knew that there were going to be interruptions. I think you don't want to surprise RuPaul that much.
No.
So that we kind of talked through what it was going to be, the basic form of it. And then we would work that and see how it turned out. And if we needed to tweak something, maybe we'd amp something up a little bit. But there's a lot of improv within the guidelines of like the questions that we're asking. There's a lot of that. And I'm trying to think of the other ones, but I mean, I'm really involved in Up Close. I mean, we do have writers, and they do come up with little jokes and little zingers for us to pitch it at each other, which is fun. But the idea of it is there are certain things in it that are, left open to us to just play.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I was gonna say, you see that a lot in the game show segment with Pepe. I mean, there's just a lot of lateral territory there for Bill to just do what he does with Pepe and do it. And I mean, he does it so well with Pepe. It works fantastically.
It really does. Yeah, that was a fun piece of the show too, because you've got you have people that are coming in from who knows where. They're just game show contestants, and we're trying not to tell them anything, just so that they would be as real as possible.
I was wondering how much of how aware these quote unquote contestants were of what they're going to be subjected to.
I'm not sure, and I'm actually not sure who I don't think that they knew who was going to win. I don't remember knowing. I think that was just literally probably Bill's whim or Pepe's whim, and I think that's. I mean, maybe they had discussions. I don't know. I'm not sure that the game show rules really apply for this particular show. I don't know.
I don't think there's any rules that apply to it besides
part of anything goes.
On one of them that they're, it has the contestants painting each other with makeup.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's just hysterical. And then Miss Piggy comes in and Eric's reaction to that, like, what happened to you? Someone locked the doors.
Yeah.
I mean, it had me in hysterics.
Oh, good. Well, I'm glad. I mean, it is. It was fun to make, you know, and we had great guest stars that were game to play as well as our contestants, but we had great guest stars that were along for the ride and they were all down to play, which was fun.
Yeah. Like even some of the Swedish Chef ones, for me, that segment got better as it went on.
Mm-hmm.
The first one, it was okay. I see this thing. The MC of the segment really does steal the show. The second one though, I mean, that one's hitting the ground running. That's the one with Tergio.
Trejo, Danny Trejo.
Yes, Danny Trejo. Thank you.
Oh, with the tacos, yes.
Yes, taco one, and just the idea. Okay, Swedish Chef needs to come up with something, so he grabs a mole, wraps it in a shell. It just subjects it to the mole's just happy, just so
and sour cream on it, I think.
Oh yes, well thank you, this is very nice.
Yeah, it's cozy. I think he said something, it's cozy or something, I don't know, but it's fun. It's a, you know, and that's that zany Muppet humor that everybody loves, and we tried to infuse that as often as we could into the show.
It plays off so well. Something that Mike said, that you guys had a lot of fun doing this. And
oh yeah,
it comes across, because, and I've said this with a lot of other shows, you can tell when a cast is having fun doing something, you can tell when a cast is just showing up.
Yeah.
And when a cast is showing up, that it's, you know, the energy isn't there, but when they're having fun, it just keeps going and it is fantastic.
I agree. I think, and we all were having fun. It's the thing about that I love about my job is that one of the things I love, I get to laugh all day long. You know, I mean, these are my very good friends that I get to work with, and we're just laughing and trying to make each other laugh. And it makes the work environment just a joy. It really does.
And it seems to me that you guys have almost kind of, it's gone back to it now where the Muppets, it's a real full crew now that you guys are together on Sesame Street and then go on to do the Muppets. Whereas that there was sort of, for a while, it was kind of divided where there was the Muppet Show crew and the Sesame Street crew, with maybe Jerry and Jim and Frank going, and maybe Richard a little bit, going back and forth between the two. But now it's a full crew of, you know, you and Eric and Peter.
And David Rudman. Yeah, four of us hop over and do the Disney Muppets, yeah.
And are both.
Yep.
And I think that you can kind of feel that camaraderie is now back, I guess, or is now present.
Yeah, I agree with that. I do agree with that. It's you know, I've now, looking back, I've worked with some of these guys for over 22 years now, which is a long time. But it's been a great ride, and I've been having the time of my life. I'm so grateful for what I get to do.
Matt, that's almost how long that we've been working together.
Really?
Yeah.
I just met you. Oh, you're talking to Matt. I'm sorry. You guys have been working, and you've known each other for 22 years or so.
15?
15, actually.
Yeah, 15.
It feels close. Like 20.
I don't age well. I don't age well on people.
Oh boy.
It is brilliant. Not only the camaraderie, but like you said, the chemistry.
Yeah.
The chemistry between, you know, that you guys build, and that you know each other so well that you can pull off stuff that, you know, improvisational. Yeah. I do speak for a living occasionally. The improv part of it works out sometimes so well, or even better, because you just know each other and you know what's going to push the other person.
Yeah, I agree with that. It does. We are better because we know each other so well. And having a group that's tight like ours, whether it's on Sesame Street or whether it's with the Disney Muppets, is it's kind of one of the magic tricks, one of the keys, one of the secret ingredients to making us successful, I think.
I know you're pressed for time, and I would be amiss if I did not bring up again Below the Frame, which was something you were doing on Facebook a little while ago. One reason or another, you know, you're switching it now to a unfold on podcast. So where are we going to be able to hear that, and where can we expect?
Well, you're going to be able to hear it wherever your podcast needs are met, wherever that is.
Excellent.
When August 12th is the first episode, and we'll be talking to Stephanie DeBruzzo. And it's been really fun, I'll be talking to Stephanie DeBruzzo. It's been a lot of fun to put together because I've had some time. I've had some months to put this together, which is great because when we did it on Facebook Live, it was literally live over our lunch breaks. And we were trying to put this thing on as quickly as we could and still maybe eat a bite of food. And so it became a little bit. And then, you know, we had PR stuff and other things that we had to do during lunch, pre-records, who knows what. So it just became difficult. It became, you know, not as fun, but it was still fun to do. So we decided, I decided that we'd do this as a podcast. It has a little bit of a format where it's just an in-depth interview with a Muppet performer or a writer. I talked to Jim Lewis Muppet Wranglers. I talked to some Muppet Wranglers. There are fake ads in it for things that you need if you are a puppeteer, like arm rods or live hands or lip sync, good lip sync. There's little ads for that. And then we also have a section on some episodes when we don't have fake ads. We are going to talk about Jerry Nelson. And I'm very excited about that because I have something kind of special that we're going to share of Jerry's that has never been shared before. And so it's going to be really cool. And I'm excited about it.
Well, I'll make sure to link it on my Facebook page for everybody. I'll even put it out on Twitter so that way people are knowing it. It's about next week or so.
Yeah, a couple weeks.
Yeah. And
time lapse. Yes.
I do have to apologize. I know you did one on Carol's retirement. I haven't been able to bring myself to watch that yet.
It's okay. It's really good. It's beautiful. It's really nice.
No, I mean in the best of ways that I know it's going to bring out the emotions in me and I'll probably start crying. I can admit at this point in my life, I'm not too proud to cry. And I just wasn't ready to go through those emotions. I mean, I still watch the 1978 Christmas special every year.
Me too.
What I saw in the past that you did was excellent. So I'm really looking forward to what you guys have coming forward on that. You bringing in Leonard's buddy, Marty Robinson?
Yes, I talked to Marty I've got a group of mentees that are young performers that are kind of up and coming and that we are kind of bringing along. Marty and I are bringing them along on the Sesame Street side. And they are kind of our cast of our fake ad players. And so they are performing the ads along with like Marty is in them and, Tyler Bunch and Stephanie DeBruzzo kind of lend a hand every once in a while as well. And so, yeah, it's great. The conversation with Marty is so much fun.
Oh, excellent. Yeah. Well, I have a 3-4-year-old coming in bothering me.
That's what being a dad is, I guess.
You have five kids. You know how it is.
I know how it is. I'm surprised that nobody's come in here yet, but they're probably off playing video games. You'll see what that's like soon enough.
Mine were. They just decided to come in anyway. And now I got him what he wanted and he left. Matt Vogel, thank you so much for everything. This has been fantastic. Really appreciate it. I know you're a very busy guy. So the fact that you're able to take some time for all of our listeners, where can they find you? I know you're out there on the socials and stuff. So where can they find you?
Well, I've got a website. It's mattvogel.com that I don't update ever. I have a Twitter and an Instagram at Welcome Matt V. That's Welcome Matt with two T's and one V. Welcome Matt V. And then below the frame, we have an Instagram that's at below the frame. And on Twitter, it's at below frame. But you get all the same information there that you'll get from Welcome Matt V.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much, Matt. You have anything, Leonard, anything last to?
No, I'm tapped.
He's good. Thank you guys so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks.
I want to thank both our guests, Matt Leonard and, of course, Matt Vogel, for joining us this week and talking about Matt Vogel's career and Muppets Now and Sesame Street and all those wonderful things. What are your thoughts on Muppet Now? One episode is out. Another one is on its way shortly. What do you think of the show? You heard our thoughts. I want to hear your thoughts. Join the conversation on our Facebook group, facebook.com/DisneyMarvelsPodcast, or our Facebook group, which is facebook.com/group/DisneyMarvelsPodcast. Find us also on the Twitter, @DisneyMarvels. You can shout it out there. You can also email the show with any of your answers, suggestions, or thoughts to DisneyMarvels@gmail.com. You can also leave us a voice message through the Anchor app or Web Anchor website. Links to all these are in the show notes. I want to thank you for your time. I know how little time we all have and how crazy everything has been, and the fact that you're taking some of this time, some of your time, limited time, and spending it with us means so much to me. And I really can't thank you enough. But I need to ask you some more favors. I apologize. But please, tell your friends. Tell, you know, shout it out. Put it out on their Facebook, our Twitter, Instagram, whatever you're on. And put it out there. You know, check out this show. They, you know, Disney Marvels. They got a lot of stuff going on here. A lot of cool people that have been on. You know, check them out. Make sure. You know, spread the word. Because the bigger this Disney family is, the better. Walt believed in a big Disney family, and so do I. Also, even better, go to iTunes. Go on iTunes, give us a good rating. You know, you could leave a comment there too. That really helps get the show noticed. We're doing great with the 5-star ratings. Please, keep it going. You know, the more 5-star ratings, the more people are going to get to find out about this show. And it only takes a quick couple clicks there. And really, it means so much that so many of you have given us a 5-star rating. I can't say enough. But one last thing, because I can't say enough, is, we're coming close to our 100th episode, our centennial episode, and I want to hear from you. I wanted to hear from you about, either some of your favorite moments over these past 100 episodes, or, you know, just say congratulations, or a hi, or something. So either, if you want, just email me a message through DisneyMarvels@gmail.com, or, which I would be even greater because then I can play it on the show, send me a message, a voice message. Either record one on your phone and you can send it to that email address, or again, you go to the Anchor website and do it through there. Either way, I would love to make you a part of my 100th episode, or our 100th episode. So please send me your wishes or favorite moments. All right, whatever you want, just keep it clean. While you're also doing all this other stuff, don't forget to subscribe to the shows. This way you always know when new episodes are posted. And while you're at it, consider becoming a premium subscriber to the show so you can help us out, help pay for keeping the lights on. You can do this over at anchor.fm/DisneyMarvels/support, or on our Patreon page where you can get some cool stuff back in return. The links are also in the show notes, because remember, this show is brought to you by listeners like you. Hey. As crazy as everything is going on now, and it's one thing after another, and the uncertain times just keep going. And it can really seem overwhelming. Don't let it do that. Don't let it make you feel like you're not worth it. Or that it's all darkness. Because there isn't. And you know where that light is? The light is inside of you. You grab hold of that light. It will warm you up. It will heal you. And it will consume you. And you will be a light. You will be a beacon. Be your own hero. Don't give up. Don't ever give up or ever give in. Keep moving forward. Believe in yourself like I believe in you. Now I'd like to end this week with a quote from Walt Disney himself. Out of our years of experimenting and experience, we learned one basic thing about bringing pleasure and knowledge to people of all ages and conditions, which goes to the very roots of public communication. That is this: the power of relating fact as well as fable in story form. Again, that's from Walt Disney. I want to thank you again, and I'll see you next time.